1903. The place, the New York Academy of Music, a vaudeville house on Manhattan's Lower East Side. Short films had appeared on vaudeville bills as novelty acts for several years. But here, for the first time, a film was telling a complete story in the language of movie pictures. The victim closely as he's exchanged for a dummy. The first in movie history. The sheriff and his men are guests at the square dance, but when the news arrives, the great granddaddy of all chases gets underway. Robbery was produced by the studio of Thomas Alva Edison and directed by Edwin S. Porter. Porter was discovering the basic element of movie making, editing, the putting together of scenes to tell a story. Retribution creeps up on the villains in the woods of New Jersey. And the pattern is set for thousands of movie chases to follow. Year 1905, the director again, Edwin S. Porter, is setting this time the streets of New York. Audiences forgot they were sitting on hard seats in dingy Nickelodeons. They found themselves chasing with the pursuers or running with the pursued. Edwin S. Porter's chases were ahead of their time. For the next 5 years, other one-reelers remained static and routine. But then, around 1910, the work of a new director made audiences sit up. A D.W. Griffith film started pretty much like any of the one and two-reelers of the day. Grace, a railroad telegrapher. Her admirer, Jack the Expressman. And a payroll. But as the picture unrolled, audiences began to sense that something new was being added. Griffith was following his characters closely with his camera, cutting to make action in several places seem continuous. He was creating for the first time the kind of suspense which is still the basic ingredient of action films today. Thank you. want two things, the key to the safe and to keep Grace from signaling for help. In 1920, Griffith made the film version of the famous play, Way Down East. And the most memorable sequence was the chase over the ice. Lillian Gish played Hannah, an honest farm girl betrayed by a callous playboy. Despondent, her baby dead, she stumbled aimlessly into the New England river. Out searching for her is the farm boy who loves her, Richard Boston. Filming was done on the frozen Connecticut River. No doubles were used.
Em breve, voltaremos com nossa programação no Filme Nights.
By the mid-20s, movies were big business, presented in lavish picture palaces. Sets were lavish, too. This Cecil B. DeMille chase begins at a masquerade ball on the French Riviera. Jetta Goodall, as a European princess, is with Rod LaRocque. She is about to be kidnapped by the jealous Baron Garcia, played by Noah Beery. Baron signals his henchmen, who conceal her under a Mardi Gras mask. The Baron, an international scoundrel, previously tricked Jetta into marriage. She escaped. Now he is determined to have her back. Take her to his castle fortress across the bay.
Douglas Fairbanks Sr., handsome, athletic, daredevil, king of the movies. Doug chased and was chased on land and sea. Here is the masked Robin Hood of the Pampas. He challenges the corrupt sheriff and his cohort to catch him.
Em breve, voltaremos com nossa programação no Film and Arts.
The Weekly Serial, The Interrupted Chase. Pearl White, the first queen of the series. And here she is in 1914's classic, The Perils of Pauline. With no possible escape in sight, and this week, suddenly from nowhere, Pearl's greatest rival, Ruth Roland. From 1914 to 1940, the serials dominated the Saturday afternoons of every school-age kid in the country. 20 minutes of thrills and chills, and always the breathtaking, cliff-hanging ending. Thank you. In their first half century, the movies came up with just about every variety of chase. The film, Jungle Treasure, was made on location in the heart of the Amazon. The story is fiction, but the jungle and its creatures are real. Explorer. He and his guide are in the Brazilian jungle on a search for a rare butterfly. Piranha can strip a man's flesh from his bones in 40 seconds. A chunk of meat to distract the piranha while the guide goes in to dislodge the boat.
Voltaremos com nossa programação no Film & Arts.
jungle, intent on his search for the butterfly, the scientist becomes separated from his guide. Throughout the day, the pursuit of bad cowboys by good cowboys, or vice versa, is perhaps the most familiar movie chase of all. And the pattern was set years ago by William S. Arthur. Hart's last picture, Tumbleweeds, in 1926, was based on the Oklahoma land rush. The federal government was to open the vast Oklahoma territory to all on a first-come, first-claim basis. Even the ranchers who had previously bought land from the Indians had to restate their claims, racing against thousands of new homesteaders. Bill saved one of these ranchers. Land grabbers were after his land and had him framed and thrown into a stockade. He must escape and beat them to it.
Thank you.
Hart rode many chases, but this, his last, made at the age of 56, was his greatest. The recruiting officer decides Johnny will be more valuable to the South as a railroad engineer than as a soldier. Sorry. Next. I said next, buddy.
Voltaremos com nossa programação no Filme Nars. Rodolfo.
And if the army doesn't want Johnny, his girl Annabelle doesn't want any part of him either. Army camp, a daring plan is hatched. A group of picked men are to infiltrate behind southern lines, steal a locomotive, and destroy communications. Which locomotive? The General, of course.
still right on schedule, Johnny is unaware that among his passengers are the Northern Raiders, disguised as Southerners. And by coincidence, his girlfriend, Annabelle, who has never forgiven him for not being in the Army. The train has stopped, and now the Union plan goes into action. Keaton's heroines had one thing in common. They were all dumb, and Annabelle will be no exception. She's forgotten something, and as she goes back to get it, can't get through, and they proceed to carry out the rest of their plan. To avoid suspicion, the Northerners change into Confederate gray. But Johnny doesn't give up. He races all the way to the next town to get help and another engine. For the missing infantry, he decides to try artillery. The raiders, confident that no one could have followed them, stop to take on water. Right over the top of his own locomotive. Thank you. get as far away as possible. The raiders now believe they're being followed by an entire train of artillery. To slow their pursuers down, they release one of their boxcars. The locomotive itself. And now, one of the most beautifully timed sequences of all motion picture comedy. Just at this moment, the Southern Army is retreating. Johnny's just too busy to notice the retreat and steams on northward. Johnny is chopping wood. Confederate gray turns to Union blue. Behind enemy lines. Hopeless, he decides his only chance is to get off the train and hide. The point at which Johnny left his train is close to Union headquarters. It's where prisoner Annabelle has been taken, and it's where the Union staff is planning their campaign. A Union soldier is on guard. Two Union soldiers. Able to overhear the Union plan to send a supply train to support General Parker's attack at Rock River Bridge.
Mm-hmm.
When dawn breaks, Johnny discovers that right in the middle of the supply depot is his own locomotive, the General. His mind goes to work.
Em breve, voltaremos com nossa programação no Filme Nights.
The locomotive chase starts all over again in the opposite direction. Other great comedians treated their heroines with dignity and respect, primarily for pathos. Keaton, however, deliberately used his heroines as comedy foils, almost as props. Exactly the same treatment they gave him on the way up. Water as well as wood. Pursuers haven't been delayed enough. Thank you. take time to get rid of the boxcar. The Union attack depends on getting their supplies across Rock River Bridge, and Johnny knows his job is to destroy it. His plan, to set the bridge on fire. The supply train for the northern attack is almost there too. Johnny's idea is to climb back on the tender and light the fire with the burning log. But watch the graceful Annabelle. Back up and you jump. Annabelle backs up. Changes into one of the Confederate uniforms left in the cab. He alerts division headquarters. Stem the attack. Every last man. One of the classic moments of comic satire. The general decides the bridge is not impassable and orders the train across. Is a comedy, the battle scenes have the scope and realism of Matthew Brady photographs of the Civil War brought to life. But the most remarkable thing is that through all the inferno and chaos, Keaton weaves his nonsense so expertly that two great armies serve as mere straight men. Hits the dam, and and the position of the Northern troops becomes untenable. Victorious Southern troops march home. Johnny is told, "What do you mean by wearing this uniform? You were never enlisted in the army." Even as a lieutenant, the minute he's with Annabelle, there are problems. But a man who's recaptured the general and won a battle single-handed can easily find a solution.
Senate Chase. Senate's protege, his favorite, and the star who worked with him longest was Mabel Normand. Senate produced several full-length features starring Miss Normand. One of them was The Extra Girl. While Mabel is getting the dog lion to drink, the crew takes him off to the set, and the lion trainer puts the real lion in his place.
Em breve, voltaremos com nossa programação no Filme Nights.
And now to the Senate chase. Ben Turpin.
Thank you.